is going to happen. And then when the gentleman or the minister begins to answer the question, then he jumped in and said, well, as if it was his idea, and then he started talking and putting a lot of stuff like that in. Anyway, I wanted you to see it for yourself, that it's really the other minister that you need to listen to, because he said that at this particular time, there will be the revealing of God's hidden ones.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So there's a group of people, I don't know who they are, but they've been hidden on this earth.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Amen.
And he said, like Elijah, they were on the mountainside eating hidden food.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now I know when you talk, when he's talking, I can sense he doesn't know this message. But that's how high he went, that he recognized there's something going on. Amen. He said, and they were receiving, and then he had gotten at that point. He says, you mean like Elijah? The gentleman says, exactly, right? Like Elijah had to hide away and was eating hidden food that was provided by God himself. And so there are people in the land that are hidden away, and they have nothing, he says, with institutionalized religion. Amen. He says they have nothing to do with that. All they feed upon is the word of God.
Hey, hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, and so he's talking along that line and saying that there is a great revival coming. That's when Benny Hinn jumped in and said, yes, and I believe that revival is going to start with the death of Billy Graham. Right? But they highlighted it as if the entire thing was Benny Hinn's prophecy. It wasn't Benny Hinn's prophecy. That man, whoever his name is, or was, and I wanted to show you that here today so you can see and hear it for yourself. I found it very difficult because to be able to download it from every source. I don't know if some of you brothers tried, and I don't know what they're doing, but luckily I was able to capture it because a brother from Colorado had sent it to me before the brothers mentioned it here from the pulpit as such. But the fact is that that is what was said by a man who really is not, you can tell he's not in the message. Brother Benson, when you see they start to recognize the Pentecostals and particularly begin to recognize what is actually happening, he said it won't be too long then. Watch. They're going to beat the path to your door. They're going to want to know. It's the foolish virgins now trying to find oil for their lamp.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
Because the little oil or whatever that they had in their wonderful teachings and preachings that even had a little anointing on them is going to start and is running out.
Amen.
Until they don't even have the inspiration anymore. And it all is pouring into the bride, and they're going to be left right there with empty lamps.
Amen.
With nothing in it. Friends, we're in the last hour.
Amen.
The songwriter says, as Brother Brown loved to sing, the day of redemption is near.
Oh, yes.
Men's hearts are failing for fear. Be filled with God's Spirit. Your lamps render clear. Look up, your redemption is near. I sang that and I feel like crying already. Wow, what an hour that we're living in, brothers and sisters. I hope you realize the day, the time, the season of who we are. We look, we appear, we walk, we talk, we move, and have to eat and work like everybody else. But there's something buried within us, amen, that come from eternity and
hallelujah.
To go back to eternity.
Amen. Hallelujah.
We don't belong on this earth.
Amen.
We are just a passing through.
Yes.
Amen. All our inheritance, our treasures, everything is laid up beyond the blue. So Brother Branham said that he heard the voices in heaven said, we are resting on that. We can say the same thing while we are here in this life. We are resting on that.
Amen.
We're resting on the word. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord God. Let's go to our scripture, Genesis 1, 1 to 5. And we're going to recap a lot of what we said. And move on just a little bit. Praise God. God knows he has his own purposes. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm so glad I can say that I'm one of them. Praise God. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form, and theologians call this the chaotic earth. And void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, and it was good. God divided the light from the darkness, and God called the light day, the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Praise God. Father, we ask your blessing. We pray you will make sense out of this and show to us out of your word your whole purpose and plan. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord God. Amen and amen. Praise God. The Lord bless you. Please be seated. Amen. Yes, sir. Just to go back over the scripture, says here, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. Now, full stop, right there. Now, you know there's the creationists, and there are the theological point of view, where some said, well, these Christians are saying that the earth was created 6,000 years ago. It was created 6,000 years. It can't be 6,000 years. That's all not true, because we are finding dinosaur parts and Orontosaurus parts and everything else. We're finding all this pterodactyls and all kinds of animals. It's indisputable. Right, go up here into Alberta. You just go into Alberta. And there, in the badlands of Alberta, you're going to find the footprints of these prehistoric beasts and animals right there in the rocks. And they're also finding the remains in the rocks. So how do we reconcile the two things where it says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth? And they say, you say 6,000 years, and they can produce animals. Definitely. That are thousands and thousands of years old. Right? But the mind of a prophet gives us the answer.
Amen.
God created the heaven and the earth. He says, we don't know when that was. That would be 20 million years ago. Now, we don't know when that was. The 6,000 years you are counting, you don't understand. God created the heavens and the earth. And then what happened? And the earth was without form and void. The earth became chaotic. We know when God makes anything, it's perfect. But all of a sudden, it says it's chaotic. And that's when he quoted or talked from Dr. Pember's Earth's Earliest Ages to explain that between verses 1 and 2, millions of years could have passed. Right? And we know when you read the book of like Isaiah and Ezekiel that Satan was called King of the North. And he was called the God of this world. He actually was the one that was governing the universe. right? He was the governor of the universe, making his nest in the stars, living on this star, that star. Amen. He was the real star, too, if you want to put it that way, running to and fro all the time. But he was the one that was controlling God. But then you know the rest of the story with his rebellion against God and everything else and being cast down. And God brought a judgment against whatever civilization he had. At that time, God brought a great judgment upon it. And that judgment is what brought the earth into chaos. And everything got broken up. They found some of these animals dead with even grass still sticking in their whatever. It just suddenly struck them. However it was, we don't know, right? You had the Great Ice Age, where they carved out mountains and valleys and everything else like that, struck the entire earth. And so God took him from that position. And of course, we know that God created man. And that's the 6,000 years ago that they're talking about. That's when God put man on the earth, right? Because after that, we understand clearly that's where they start to come from. And then they think that, oh, the whole thing is not true. But it is absolutely true. It's the Word of God. The Word of God is having conflict with them, with the creation of these big animals and stuff like that. The Bible talks about Leviathan, talks about beasts and animals that we don't know what they are. They're supposing that maybe this Leviathan is a whale, or Leviathan is this, or this animal is that. They're supposing, they don't know. But there were other beasts that were on the earth here. We'll talk about that separately another time. But praise the name of the Lord, brother, sister. And so, God created the earth, and then later, you know, he created nature, he created the light, brought all these things upon the face of the earth. Now, our talk here today is about God's jigsaw puzzle. And what we're saying here that is God started out with the entire thing like a great big puzzle that would always puzzle our minds. It'll puzzle the mind and still puzzling the minds of the scientists, of all the biologists, all the great teachers. They're still wondering and they're still puzzled because they don't know what happened. I was talking, relating to a young man and explaining to him that anytime you hear a word ends with the word ology, from Greek, ology, it means science. So when you hear they say theology, it's a man who got qualified through education to understand the science of the Bible, right? You say psychology, it's the science of the mind. Biology, zoology, and you go right on and you see, you place that word, it'll give you a little clearer understanding, is that you're arrived at a place where you have been able to make this thing into a science, right? So that's where you get theology and eschatology and geologism, whatever else, right? That's where they got it from. But the Bible is like a jigsaw puzzle. The world is like a jigsaw puzzle. And by their wisdom, they're able to find the pieces, but they don't know how to put it together. They got all these sciences and different ologies and parts of nature, parts of the earth and everything else, and they're trying to put it together and they're causing more pollution. Right? They're putting an arm where a leg should be. And they're putting an eye where there's supposed to be an ear. And change the entire thing, and all they're doing is cutting and making a Frankenstein mess of God's whole creation. The environment destroyed, right? The environment is being destroyed completely by human ignorance, which they call wisdom, but human wisdom, which is ignorance to God, because it doesn't fit into God's program, okay? Yes, so God created the earth, he has a system, he has a way. He knows why he put a the mountain. But then you take it from the mountain, you bring it down in the valley because you like it there. He puts out the beautiful wild flowers with their variety out in the field and allows them to exist together, nodding their heads and spilling their perfume upon the breeze, making happy the hearts of the passers-by. But what happens? Oh, I love that! So they take the flower from its native environment where God put it and you move it to put it where I think it looks more beautiful over here. That's the spirit of the devil. Right? He thinks he can do things better than God. So he just move this around, move it there to make it look more beautiful, he thinks. Oh, look, that grass is wild grass, so I'm going to bring it and put it and mow it. So it can be even. God don't want it even. God wants it all even. God wants everything to be unique. God doesn't like uniformity. Right? We don't have a message uniform or a Bible uniform or a Christian outfit that we have to wear when you come to church with white gloves and a dark jacket or a black skirt and a white thing on your head and whatever else. And say, oh, those are Christians, my God. Or I come up here with a collar around my neck. Oh, that's the minister. No, God doesn't go for that at all. Yeah. Amen. You can wear it if you want, but that was not God's plan. Mm-hmm. It doesn't fit into God's plan and God's purpose at all. Because God's a God of variety.
That's right. Amen.
God loves variety. We used to sing in the Sunday school, red and yellow, black and white, all the precious in the sight. Amen. Praise God. Everything is beautiful. In its own time. Praise God. So, the whole thing is so chaotic and they can't make sense of it. And they do not understand that if you want to put together a Ford car that fell apart, you gotta go back to the manufacturer. Is that right? Mm-hmm. You can't run from Ford and go to Jaguar and ask them to give you the parts to fix your Ford. No, because a different manufacturer.
Mm-hmm.
God made this earth, God made you, God made everything that's here, mm-hmm. and they need to go back to the Bible, back to the Word of God,
hallelujah.
Back to the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. for Him to give them the wisdom and the understanding of how to be able to exist upon the earth until we are called home.
Yeah,
praise God. Yes, sir, total confusion. We understand that the Bible is like a jigsaw puzzle. Now, I have a little chart I made up here, which I was going to throw it up there. But before the foundations, God sat alone, and you know He was by Himself. We won't go through all of that. And then came to the time of creation, created the earth, explained to you about the earth's earliest ages, right, which many writers have referred to. And then later came man and nature that was here upon that we are born. And God Himself was sitting in eternity, the great Spirit of God, wanting to express Himself. Right? He wanted to be able to come to the ultimate expression of His being.
Amen.
And so, through condescension, through amorphic, God started to unfold Himself down.
Amen.
Amen. First to be over His creation. Then one day He would be with His creation. Then later on in His ultimate achievement, He will live in His creation.
Amen.
Amen.
So God now began to try to express Himself through His creation. And all He had, first of all, was nature to express Himself through. So God could be seen in the light. God could be in the stars. God revealing Himself through the moon. Amen. The heavens declare the glory of God.
Amen.
Then make Him manifest. Explain to you how that God's first Bible was written in the skies. Brother Branham said that, and I'm saying that so that you won't just take my word for it. But the God's first Bible was in the skies, the zodiac, and the meaning of each one of those signs has a meaning. and an appliance, then we understand that after a while, all the patriarchs, they did not have a written Bible, but they, as the scriptures always say, can you look at the seasons and look at the times and understand? Amen. Look at the stars. Look at this. Look at that. And always pointing them back to nature. That's the wise men even knew Jesus was coming by the stars. Because in those days there was not yet a written Bible. Amen. King James wasn't born. Right? And all these things were not put together as one, as yet. So these men and women were operating purely by faith.
Amen.
They were operating by revelation. Amen. Their faith was not just in the written pages of a book we call the Bible, which we have to have our faith in the Word of God.
Amen.
But the real Word of God is not just the, is not the written Word of God. It's the unwritten Word of God. Amen.
Amen.
What I'm saying is that words are just a vehicle to transfer meaning.
Right.
It's not the words, it's the meaning. Right? That's what you need to get, the inside meaning of the Word. Amen. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh, dwelt among us, and so on. And but we didn't recognize who he was. He came to his own, and they knew him not. Amen. See? Now they're hooked on the written Word. Not understanding it's not the rhema, it's the logos.
Amen.
It's the life that's back on that Word. Jesus himself said, the letter kills, but the Spirit of God gives it life.
Amen.
Amen. So it's not the letter that we're choosing to understand. Bible lessons and all those things are very good. But it's not Bible lessons, it's the Lord him.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. It's the Lord him, the person that is back of the Word. So it was God expressing himself through the nature, and we see his beauty in the flower, the beauty in the fruits, the beauty in the animals. Amen. We see God's beauty in the thunder, the lightning, the rain, the storm. God's beauty is everywhere.
Amen.
Oh my, artists and men of inspiration are never out of material. Because God is so infinite in his being and in his creativity.
Amen.
And his mastery of his universe. That there's no one person that can capture that.
Amen.
And therefore, God first of all began to deal with the patriarchs, Abraham, Jacob, Joseph, Isaac, Jacob, all of them down through the ages, dealt with these patriarchs who had no written Bibles. Then later on, God began to deal with the Israel through the prophets. And through the prophets, you know, a prophet is a man who was predestinated by God, that God would use him as a place to speak out his word. For God's the Spirit, he would possess those prophets, get in them, use them, speak through them, perform signs, wonders, and miracles through them, and then he'll leave their bodies and, you know, leave them. All right. And so, brothers and sisters, that's the way that it used to be. God expressing himself through those prophets and making himself known. So, then we know that every action of these patriarchs and prophets, every action, every even human action that was coming through them and strange things like they did, it was not just of their own doing,
amen,
but it was God acting through them.
Amen.
In the New Testament, we call it Acts of the Apostles. But it wasn't the Acts of the Apostles. It was exactly what it was. Until it became a light thing to the people in the message when they hear Brother Branham said, "Thus saith the Lord." They think that was Brother Branham saying, "Thus saith the Lord." Like you and I standing here can say, "Thus saith the Lord." It wasn't like that. It was God himself speaking through the man.
Amen.
And he wanted us to understand that. So what he preaches a message called, the Spirit speaks through the prophet. Is that right?
Yes.
He preaches a message saying, he says, don't look at the signpost. Amen. A prophet is just a signpost that God's fixing to do something.
Amen.
He says, don't spend your time just looking at the signpost, but hear the voice of the sign.
Amen.
The voice that was coming through the sign. That's the voice that's on tape.
Amen.
That's the voice that you should listen to. So that's not just, oh, I'm going to hear Brother Bradley. Oh, no. You're hearing Brother Bradley's voice, but that's not Brother Bradley. You've been blessed to hear the voice of God in these last days.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. That is what we really experience it. That is why even though you feel normal, you feel ordinary, you are actually living a supernatural life with the ability to recognize the voice of God in these last days.
Amen.
It separates you. It identifies you, my friends, from every other being on the planet.
Amen.
A super people and a super race that are now living above every gravitational pull of the devil.
Amen.
He's not a magnet to pull you to the world,
right. But
you are overcoming in the middle of that magnetic worldly influence that he has in this earth.
Amen.
And even beyond that, he's getting mad because you're pulling away.
Amen.
You're pulling away.
Amen.
Instead of him drawing you this way, trying to be glued to his way of life,
Amen. You're
being pulled away.
Amen.
From his gravitational pull, amen, until you're sailing into the great beyond in the presence of the living God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise God. You know, from Cape Canaveral, from down in Florida, they fired a wonderful rockets. It's marvelous to see them going up with a flame of fire behind them. That's what it takes to put you in the spirit.
Amen.
That's what it takes to make you put you in the presence of Almighty God.
Amen.
You gotta have quickening power. You gotta have a trust.
Amen.
You gotta have something back of you.
Amen.
To get you there, brother.
Amen.
But all the astronauts have testified that they've come under the G forces. Listen to what forces they come under. But I'm preaching now. They come under the influence of the G forces.
Amen.
And they sit in that rocket and they said they feel like 100 pounds is on their chest, pressing them back against that seat. Right? And they're pressed against that seat like that. And that's how you feel now. The world is on your shoulders, pressing you down, and you feel you can't get out. Your pressure, trial, trouble, but all of this is holding you inside of that gene. But they said as soon as they hear, bah! And that rocket breaks through the sound barrier, they said all of a sudden the weight is lifted, everything feels free.
Amen.
And now the rocket is able to sail and go wherever it wants.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
With that fleece, they can become invisible, they can do all kinds of miraculous stuff like that. But on their journey, there was like a little island in the ocean, and on that island, there were sorceresses, sirens, women that were beautiful and had voices like angels, and they would sing and call out and say, come, come. And then the sailors, after having been for months on the ocean, they get there. Oh, there are women over there. Oh, there's a city over there. Oh, we can get water, we can get food, we can get rest. We can go over there and get it. And then they would start to guide their ships in that direction. And those voices were just guiding them to go where there were rocks. And every ship would be destroyed and become shipwrecked.
Amen.
But when they got to that place, Jason told the sailors to shut their ears and sail on.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Sail on. Praise God. And I'm telling you, there's a lot of voices in this world here today. And those voices are calling out to you. Come this way, you'll get success. Go this way, you'll fulfill your ambition. Do this, and that will happen. Amen. But all you'll end up with is an unfulfilled, wrecked life. You'll become a shipwreck. You'll end up in the junkyard as a junkie. Oh my, all you become is a junkie. Piece of old junk, you all praise God, hallelujah. But then, brothers, I want to encourage you, say, Lord,
amen.
Don't stop, but press your way into the presence of Almighty God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And with God's help, we'll make it through. Glory to God. God acting through the patriarchs, acting through the prophets, and then He came with the perfect demonstration of who He was. Because He's a spirit, and He has no body, physical body to express Himself through, to know, for you to know Him. That's why the Jews thought He was only a God of judgment and justice. Because all they can perceive is, oh, you break this law of judgment. You break that 10 commandments, boom, hell, this happens, that happens. And they knew Him as a God to fear. So He had to come and express and display Himself in the form of a man called Jesus Christ. Amen. But He could not be born in a sinful body, right? So He had to speak the word into the womb of a virgin and create the body for Himself. That body was called the Son. It was not without a God. But it was a body for God to come and dwell in.
Yes.
And the Father's Spirit came down and dwelt in the Son, the body, and spoke through that body, and preached through that body, and lead the teachings we have in our Bible through that body.
Amen.
God was in Christ, reconciling the world to Himself. I and my Father are one.
Amen.
Peter in the book of Acts. This Jesus is both Lord and Christ.
Amen.
He's both Father and Son.
Amen.
Yes, sir. But therefore, Acts 4:12, there is no other name given under heaven whereby we must be saved.
Amen.
But the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. That's God's name. New Testament name. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So God in Christ was expressing Himself so that the world, or the people of the world, would get to know who He was. They would know His nature, at least. They get an understanding that He's a God rich in mercy.
Yes.
He'll judge you if He has to judge you when you insist, because He doesn't want to judge you. But if you insist, He'll have to judge you. Amen. It's like the policeman sitting on the side of the road, and you're speeding coming, and you see him and you slow down. Well, maybe he picked you up on the radar, but he's not going to bother you because he sees you. You have the intent to comply. Right? I'm getting a bit legal now. All right. So, but if you say, oh, I don't care about your allure, and then you with your Mustang and your exhaust blaring. Huh? My goodness gracious, you're asking to see blue lights. You're literally begging to see blue lights. But if you insist, he's going to have to judge you. But you're bringing it down on yourself. It's not him having the desire that the devil tries to make him that he's a God of judgment and justice. No, he's not like that. But if you insist and you keep pushing in that direction, then he will have to judge you if he's going to be keeping his own word. Right? So let's come to ourselves. It was God acting through those apostles that made them move that way. What do you think when Peter shadow fall on a crippled man and the guy jumps up and gets healed? His shadow falls on somebody who was dying and they got up and resurrect back and they're alive. What was that? You think that was Peter that was holy? You know, that he was a holy pope, so that's what's happening to him? No. That's not what made it happen. It was God in here.
Amen.
What made Paul send handkerchiefs and said, take these handkerchiefs, lay it on the sick. I don't have to be there. Lay it on the sick. The vibrations of the presence of God from his body infused those handkerchiefs so that when they took it to their relatives or their friends, it brought about healing and deliverance and miracles by the power of God. It wasn't Paul or Peter. It was God in them.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so is it. Praise God. That God in this last day is doing the same thing. And it went through the dark ages and this expression stopped. And then through the seven church ages, God was trying to find people, his people, in every age that he could make himself manifest through. Now all this is repetition of what I've said, but I must repeat the word of God here. Amen. Yeah, so he's done it through the seven church ages, and we are the ones that have ended up being in the last church age. Amen. We have come to the fullness. Now, that's another teaching. How God built up his, like he, the body of Jesus Christ was made by the spoken word. So he's building up his spiritual body, the church that he's going to live in. Amen. The house that he told Solomon, you can't build me that. You can only build me a physical temple or whatever. But the tabernacle I'm going to build, I have to build it myself.
Amen.
And the tabernacle is made up of men and women. I'll live in them, I'll walk in them, they shall be my people, I will be their God.
Amen.
And a voice from heaven saying, the habitation of God is now with man.
Amen.
Hallelujah. God in Christ, Christ in the church, the kingdom is restored. That's what we are engaged in and looking at here right now. Going right back to Eden again, not on the earth, but spiritual Eden, which Eden was only a reflection of what heaven was like. Praise God. Part of heaven was like. Glory to God. So here we are at the end of the church age, ready to go into the rapture and so on. So what a time, brother, sister. I won't do any more of those outlines. No, Brother Grant speaking here. It's all just like a jigsaw puzzle. At first we got the old jigsaw puzzle all put up. Then we'd sit down and study how to put it together. We'd have something lay over on the side, a picture of what they're trying to place together to make the jigsaw puzzle come up right. That's the way the scripture is. It's cut up like that, cut up in a way by him to hide it from the eyes of the wise and prudent. You say, would God make the Bible, so puzzling to some people?
Yeah.
Over here he has an altar, over there, it's a symbol of seven candlesticks. Then on the other side you have an eagle, then you have a dove, and then there is a man over there, by a river, and then you look and then you see a star, seven stars, and all these kinds of symbols in the Bible. Well, what do you mean? What is this? What did he mean when he said that? What was that? What was this? God deliberated it in that way. Go to the unveiling of the mighty God. Here, Brother Brown is speaking. He says, many of the things I have said and done were deliberately said and done, that some of the people listening to me may go out.
Amen.
That some may come in.
Amen.
Others may be left to ponder. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, my. Yes, sir, but what the elect will understand.
Amen.
The elect will catch it. Oh,
amen.
My. He said, did not our Lord speak? Lord of God, saw that those who should not understand would not understand, but the elect would understand. Amen. So is it today.
Hallelujah.
God, allow me to speak this way.
Amen.
So that those who have to go out, go out. That those who have to come in, come in.
Amen.
Lord of God, what the
elect
of the living God.
Amen.
Praise God. That's what we're engaged in. That's what's happening around us. You are living in a supernatural atmosphere all day long.
Amen.
Because you don't have to be in church. The atmosphere is in you.
Amen.
And you create your own atmosphere.
Amen.
Praise God. You live in your own world that you created. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, sir. By the Holy Spirit that lives and walks in you. Praise God. Yes, sir. It's cut up like that to be hid from the wise and the prudent. All them smart scholars and Pharisees of today, Jesus, thank God that he hid it from their eyes and will reveal it to men that are willing to learn. Amen. If you want an example, lay aside your pattern and see what the scriptures get together. Amen. If you lay Jesus over here, go to keeping your eyes on him, place it in the Bible, then you'll get the whole thing come out right, because the entire thing will be the revelation of Jesus Christ. Amen. The Old Testament, the New Testament, all speaks of Jesus. Amen. He is the book of redemption. You believe that?
Amen.
Amen. He is the book of redemption. He was the Word. He is the Word. He will be the Word. That's bound to be him. This is the whole book of redemption with promises fitly put together. Promises of redemption for you. Healing for you. Deliverance for you. Everything that the human being needs is in this book of redemption, which is put together by God himself.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's why he is our Redeemer. This great book of redemption. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Yes, sir. The whole thing is the fall and regeneration, the picture of creation, God's whole plan revealed in Jesus Christ, the whole picture put together. Oh, this is just like putting the joy of putting a jigsaw puzzle together. Amen. You know when you're doing a jigsaw puzzle and you don't know where this piece fits, and you're trying to put it together like that, you know, you can get frustrated. Amen. Matter of fact, I was practicing yesterday so that when I came here today, I would have had a little display to show you. But some of the pieces wouldn't fit. It starts to get frustrating. But then when you find a piece and you put it, slides right.
Hallelujah.
And it fits. Oh, man!
Glory.
Victorious! Hey. Wow! It came together! Glory to God! Hallelujah! That's how we feel when revelation strikes.
Amen.
And the word begins to fit together.
Amen.
And to begin to see Christ revealed.
That's right.
In his own word.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Oh, my. Yes, sir. Praise God. Hallelujah. Mind you, we know, friends, he said here, that on the road to the Emmaus, the apostles were all discouraged. Then he stepped out of the bushes. Oh, you fools and slow about to understand. Don't you know that all the prophets and the Psalms? He says, what was he doing? What was he trying to tell them? He was identifying himself to their apostles that all the prophets, patriarchs, Psalms, and everything else was really him.
Amen.
Praise God. It was really him.
Amen.
Praise God. That's repeating again now.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Oh, who is Jesus? Where is Jesus? Where is this? Where is God? Where is he? And they don't understand. The entire thing is him.
Amen.
Being revealed again.
Amen.
The Son of Man made himself a Son of Man in this end time and is revealing himself. And we're thankful to God for that. Amen. That we're a part of that great revelation. This great consummation of what is taking place. Praise God. Hallelujah. So we have all our play parts to play. Do you believe that?
Amen.
We have our parts to play. Because we are a piece. Each one of us is a piece from that jigsaw puzzle.
Amen.
And that's why we have puzzles sometimes with our lives and the things that happen in our lives. We don't know where it fits. But there is a bigger picture that you need to fit into. Before you could have the self-satisfaction and the recognition of who you think you are. And if you think you're going to be just selfish and be by yourself, and it's going to work out right, and I know what I'm doing, it's my life, and I can, you're going to guide it and control it. Everything else, yeah, well, you may be successful to a degree, but you may not be fulfilled. You could have $1 billion and still be hollow inside and a cave that's empty and have nothing on the inside.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, sir. And a man can be simple and humble, and yet he's living a full life.
Yeah.
Amen. 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 Praise God. Oh, praise God. That's the time and the hour. Listen, we all have a part to play.
Yes, sir.
In this great jigsaw puzzle, this great event that's taking place. Amen. Before you were even born, he knows every one of us.
Amen.
We are here in this life for a purpose.
Amen.
And our God has given us something that we must do.
Amen.
May not know exactly what that is as yet. It may be that just by passing by and talking to a stranger on the street and saying a good word to them could change their life, but you don't even know it.
Yeah.
And you walk away and you get your reward in heaven. You say, well, when did I do that, Lord? When you passed that gentleman and say, well, how are you? If you didn't say, how are you, that guy would feel he didn't have a friend or nobody cared. Amen. Amen. Something that you must do.
Oh, glory. Hallelujah.
I'm not telling you about going home and praying and saying, oh, God, reveal to me what I must do. Just walk.
Amen.
You're going to walk into what you must
do. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Amen.
Oh, what is my place in? Where is my purpose? Am I supposed to be an apostle or a prophet? Am I supposed to be this or that or have this? No. You find a position. Oh, am I supposed to be this? And you'll be wondering. You don't wonder. Just walk.
Hallelujah!
None of this religious pressure, guilt complex. Amen. Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus.
That way, just to come preach because I want to make you feel guilty, and then you're going to serve God because you feel guilty.